Ari, what an amazing day we have had. I'd love to hear your thoughts and reflections on today.
I loved all of this. I really, really, really enjoyed all of the insights that were given. Being completely honest, I'm still digesting so much of what I heard today, whether from Brother Cobb, Brother Kevin Bethune, the publishing panel, as well as Daniel and Sonia's presentation just now. I'm always continuously motivated and encouraged and fed by a lot of what you guys bring every time we do this event and conference. And just again, wanted to thank you guys once more for showing up and showing out. Throwing these events are never easy. And on top of doing that, trying to throw them while also navigating the pandemic is also its own interesting yo-yo. So the fact that you guys continue to show up to these events, continue to support the speakers, the panelists, it means the world to me. The fact that we have sponsors that continue to support us in our endeavors of creating this pipeline, whether it be recruiting from the career fair, donating funding for scholarships, and allowing for programs like this to happen, we truly appreciate that from the bottom of our hearts. Especially companies like IBM, who've not only sponsored, but bring their talent back to showcase that they're putting their money where their mouth is. And they're not only recruiting these talent, but trying to facilitate safe spaces and cultures for them to thrive while in these spaces. I just wanna thank everybody for being here for the first day of the event. And I am really, really excited for you guys to see what else we have in store tomorrow. But as of right now, I am going to invite Chris Rudd to the stage. Chris, are you there? You just have to turn your camera on. How's it going, man?
Good, good. How are you?
Not too bad. How's the weather out in Chicago?
Cold today, hopefully gonna be warm tomorrow.
Not to rub it in, but I think it was a high of 80 where I'm at. So I'm a little toasty today.
Oh, nice. Thank you so much for having me.
No problem at all. Thank you for being here, and I'm going to bow out. You actually have the last word of the evening. So everyone have a good day after Chris speaks, and we'll see you again tomorrow.
All right. I will be joined shortly by Azra Sungu, who's a PhD student at ID. So we're going to talk about this together, but I hope everyone's been having a great experience with State of Black Design. I know it's been exciting. I'm very excited to be here. And so what I want to talk with you all about is a project that I led with an awesome team last year, which is rooted in my work around anti-racism. And so how do we use design to create anti-racist outcomes? And so I wanna show some slides. Oh, wrong thing. So spring of 2021, as we were all going through the pandemic and we saw the racism, the racist outcomes affecting Black, Brown, Indigenous communities, immigrant communities, the state of Illinois started an initiative called Healing Illinois, which was an initiative to start conversation around racism throughout the state. And so as designers, right, our thing is not just to talk, but to do. And so had this idea around doing pop-ups to get folks to be able to start creating anti-racist outcomes. So as many of us, I'm sure, on this call, we're tired of the talk. We're tired of the conversation. It's about action at this point. And so was able to secure funding to do these pop-ups around the city of Chicago. And so that's me. This picture's hella funny. We feel like we look like superheroes in this photo, but we like it. So my name's Chris Rudd, clinical professor at the Institute of Design, who's in my focus in design is trying to figure out new methods, frameworks for designers to create anti-racist outcomes. And Azra is a PhD student at ID, whose work starts in Turkey, working with immigrant women to manufacture different items to help support themselves and sustain themselves, and has just been a true champion and partner in this work. And these are some of the students who were working with me on the project. So we have Julian Walker, Mathila Kedambadi, Monica Villason. And so this is them out in communities around Chicago, working with folks to help them imagine anti-racist futures. So why Chicago? Chicago's my home, it's where I'm from. But as Chicago Magazine says, Chicago isn't just segregated, it basically invented modern segregation. So we are number one. I think Chicago typically rivals Milwaukee as the most segregated city in the country every year. And so growing up in this city and experiencing this segregation, you can see how it enables really horrific things to happen, particularly to Black and Brown folks. And so it's not just about thinking about racism as a, you know, something abstract that's just out here and there's nothing to do. It just is, or it's an idea. It has real life consequences. And so during the pandemic, Bloomberg News did a story about Chicago, and they said, if you draw a map of Chicago and shade the areas with more poverty, pollution, and coronavirus, it will start to look like being Black is a pre-existing condition. And so this map on the left is the city of Chicago, and the dots represent population by racial categories. And so you can see very clearly how distinctly separated we are. And so the zoomed in version on the right shows that in the loop, in the downtown area, it's particularly, you know, one race, it's red, and they typically live to be about 85 years old. If you go just 6 miles west to the blue dots, your life expectancy decreases by 13 years. And if you go south to the other set of blue dots, your life expectancy is reduced by almost 20. And so you can start to guess who are the blue dots in this map. The south and west sides are primarily Black communities, have been that way almost since, you know, Black folks came to Chicago. But these racism has very, very severe consequences for Black Chicagoans. And so my point of view is that we just can't keep talking about it. And design is situated in a way that we can start moving the needle, not by ourselves, but in conjunction with residents, in conjunction with activists, in conjunction with large parts of society. And so how do we start to do that? So the question was, can we design racism away? Not sure if that's possible. Oh, Azra, you are here. But we wanted to give it a shot. And so we started these pop-ups trying to figure out a co-design approach to anti-racism. And so we wanted to amplify a variety of voices and dialogue around anti-racism, about poverty, about and in the high poverty areas that are segregated in Chicago, develop a series of anti-racist visions, and then prototype anti-racist infrastructures. So we'll go into all of that a little deeper later on. But so we picked three specific locations. So the idea was, can design be an integrator? Can it be a force for integration, even in a city as segregated as Chicago? And so the three neighborhoods we did the pop-ups in are Washington Park, which is primarily Black. But if you can see just to the right of the yellow dot, there's splatters of lots of different colors. And so it's close enough that you can get other voices, other populations to participate. The Logan Square is primarily white now, but is a historically Latin community that is going through gentrification. So there is a hodgepodge of people in the area that, you know, because of gentrification, typically don't connect with one another. And so could design be a force for integration? And then you have the West Side and Humboldt Park. The West Side is, as you can see, it's all blue, but just next to it is all orange, which is a primarily Puerto Rican, historically Puerto Rican neighborhood. And so there's a lot of tension between those two communities. And so can design be a force to bring folks together to address racism in their communities? We decided to partner with thinking about the pop-up style of restaurants that were happening in the time. We decided to partner with Black and Brown restaurant owners and pop-up shops, community-based organizations, because one, they had the connections in the communities that we just did not have, but also they had protocols around COVID that we could adopt and keep people safe. And they're just awesome culinary folks. They you know, the food is amazing. And so trying to put money back into their businesses that were hit hardest by COVID while creating a great experience for the people who would participate with us. And so I want to turn it over to Azra to talk about the activities we created and deployed.
Hello, sorry I ran into some technical issues earlier, but very happy to be with you and very happy to share this work that we did with an amazing team and amazing people. So I'll just talk a little bit about the activities that we carried out during this pop-up. So we planned the whole thing to be a short-term engagement outdoors and to be a quick reflection that can introduce people to think that anti-racist and equitable futures are actually possible, and really put the seed of that idea that they are the actors, they are the creators of these futures. So we created a three-step reflection, and this is a very much hands-on reflection that would help people identify racism, imagine an equitable future, and prototype ways to get there for which they're the main actors. So our main goal in the identify component was to root the reflection on racism on the personal experience of people through that firsthand experience of racism, but also help them think that this is part of a system and this is not just about our personal one-to-one interactions, but we experience racism through multiple ways and it can help us think about it in a deeper level. In the imagine section, we ask people to reimagine this first past experience that they described where they were impacted by racism, but this time in an equitable future situation where we finally eradicated racism, and we ask them what could they achieve if they were not faced by these racist barriers and what would make them feel. And in the infrastructure section, this is the step where we actually get to hands-on about these features that we're imagining collectively and prototype ways to get there. So now I'm just gonna introduce you to each one of these activities and the approach that we were using. So in each one of these activities, we used worksheets that were color-coded and divided as mat libs to really help people navigate these ideas in a very simple way and to make that accessible to everyone. So in the identify section, we created a walkthrough to help folks think about their past experiences. So we moved from experiencing racism to getting impacted by racism because we're not always experiencing it in the same way. And it can sometimes make it harder for people to find out that this what they're going through is actually a result, is actually an outcome of racism. So it's helped people to think about how it touches their lives in different ways that we don't usually talk about in a more like conventional framing of racism. So we asked people what kind of barrier did they experience? What does that keep that from achieving? How do we know that this experience is racist? And most importantly, how does it make us feel? Because we cannot talk about these things as if it was a cold piece of evidence because it's a very, very personal experience. So in the next section, we recreated this experience, but this time by imagining an equitable future where we finally erased racism, a future where they can achieve their goals without getting stopped by the racist barriers. So we asked them what they would achieve in this future, how would these external things help them overcome these barriers, and again, how would it make them feel? What does this achievement feel like to really help them immerse in this experience, immerse in this future possibility, and to feel that it is out there for us to reach? In the third part, the infrastructure part, this is where we invited them to really get hands-on to explore ways to build these equitable futures because it's not a given. We are the ones to build it. And it is also part of the work to make these structures, these mechanisms through which we're building anti-racist futures really accessible to people. So we used worksheets and a collection of physical materials from post-its to Play-Dohs to like coloring sheets, a lot of different materials to help people prototype a mode of collective action that can drive bottom-up change in systems. So we really wanted to help them position themselves as the protagonist, as the actor of this change, and to feel that this is actually within their capacity. And while we designed the worksheets, we broke down the processes of things that appear black boxed from outside, such as how to create an organization, how to build a policy, because these things may not always seem accessible to people, and we really wanted to get them exposed to the inner workings of these things and that they're based on very basic principles that all of us can actually engage with. So we asked people to pick between three components of infrastructures. So they could prototype an organization, they could prototype a policy, or they could really get hands-on and engage with these materials to build an anti-racist object. And the thought that we wanted to trigger was that these are all connected as parts of infrastructures, and none of them can actually function independently, and they nurture one another. So I'll just show you a couple of examples of what these people created. So the first one here, we see an anti-racist meeting meter. So people were really like thinking about their experience and how to turn it into an anti-racist thing. So as we see this, the personal experience really helped them get creative on the side. Or another person created an organization that celebrates diversity and different cultures and really roots these in the communities. And third example is this anti-racist car insurance that really pushes back against this, against the racist algorithms that define insurance pricing and imagines a future where we do these in different ways where race is not a condition of the of the insurance pricing that you're receiving. And as we engaged with people in this collective creativity sessions, we gathered a couple of learnings and put these together in a playbook, because we believe that these engagements can easily be repeated, and we created a very simple format that can be replicated by groups, by collectives, or like by a bunch of people who are just passionate about this, like we were. And we put these together in a playbook that you can access and that you can use as resources if you want to replicate this. And you can just access it through the link. And we learned a couple of lessons, and not everything went as expected. I would like to share these with you. So this was a very short-term engagement that already also had limitations of COVID. So we had to keep social distancing, so the folks couldn't really mingle together and work together in these creativity sessions. And we would love to cultivate longer term engagements to deepen the conversation. So one barrier that we had was doing it in Chicago and the Chicago's cold weather. So even though like the weather would get very, very chilly outdoors during these workshops, people would just like stick around in surprising lengths just to keep on with this conversation. And I think we think that would be really valuable to create spaces for long-term engagement. And we noticed that immersing in these future scenarios and thinking about these possible experiences help people move beyond the mental barriers that are both coming from outside and inside. And I think creating more ways to expand this imagination of future could help people open up to these new possibilities. And we also noticed that fueling collective creativity for people was a very, very essential ingredient to help them become the protagonist of their imagined futures. So the core idea is that we are not the sole ones to build this change. This transformation is not going to happen through individuals, but through our collective work and gathering in these spaces together and thinking about this collectively really helped people recognize that they're not alone in this, and we all have this momentum and energy to make this possible. And the last thing was that, as we might expect, it can be a little bit intimidating to create something in public. So an essential part of this is to really create this safe space and foster trust and confidence where people can feel more free and confident about creating things in public. And as we work through these worksheets and ask people about what they feel, when we looked more deeply at their imagined futures, these were the words, these were the adjectives that they used to describe their experience. So we created this like word cloud that changes from valued, secure, feeling human, feeling validated, feeling alive, feeling fabulous, or simply normal, was the things that people were expressing as they engaged with the possibility of these futures where racism is no longer a part of our lives. And it was a very strong transformation, and it really felt helped people feel more empowered and to really recognize that racism is not the destiny, racism is not here to stay forever, and we have the power to change things. And yeah, this is the summary, and we invite everyone to join this endeavor to be anti-racist and to help people find out different ways to and different and creative ways to build these features together.
Thanks, Asra. I wanted to highlight two things from this work and thinking about those worksheets. So in the first one where we asked people to identify, some of the language we said is, I know it was racist because, and that was very intentional, primarily because when most of us have talked about racism, the first question is, how do you know it was racist? which is all about intent and demeaning the person who is bringing the issue to bear. And so we wanted to use language that validated their experience. So we believe you. And so just tell us how you know, and that is enough. There was no need for some type of statistical analysis, or, you know, we weren't looking to question people about their experience. We were looking to validate that the experience they had was racist. And then therefore now we can start to address the challenge that they've faced. The second thing, and this goes to the word cloud, that was an unexpected piece for me. You know, we wanted to talk about emotions primarily because we wanted to bring racism out of the philosophical realm and the abstract and bring it back to the racism affects real people, real lives, real families. That this is not just some stat you see on a paper, that people are affected. So if you think about that map and we talk about that life expectancy, Black people are robbed of decades of life and love and dignity because of racism, not just Black people, other folks of color too. But from that map, you can see very real, like, 85 to 69, those are numbers, but you have to think about all the families, all the loved ones that are impacted by those numbers. And so we wanted to bring this issue back to the human side of it. And so when we started to see those, that word cloud, where people talked about full human, these are very powerful words, especially as designers. Like, those are the words we look for when we're doing ethnographic research. But to have people feel that way in a short period of time in an imagined future was just very powerful. And so, you know, the next steps for this work is we are going to do longer term studios with communities in Chicago to go for more high fidelity prototyping. So not just a representation of an object, but actually developing objects that may involve computation and algorithms, that may involve real policy making. So knowing our limits as designers, thinking about who else needs to come into the studios to make these prototypes real for communities. And so this is also a shift for a lot of us, because it's no longer about what we create, but making space for them to create. And again, bringing together different races to do it, because I think there's a necessary understanding that racism isn't a Black issue or a brown issue. It is not on us to solve isolated from everyone else. It's an issue that we all have to coalesce around and make changes, and starting to see that these issues affect all of us, or impact all of us, even if they don't necessarily affect. So that language shift was a key learning when white Chicagoans would come and say, well, I'm not affected by it. And so helping them understand that they're impacted even if they're not affected. And so we look forward to doing these longer term studios and developing some more high fidelity prototypes that hopefully will change that map of Chicago in the near future. So thank you all so much for having us.
Thank you guys for being here. I really, really enjoyed the insights that you guys had to share, and thought that everything that you guys mentioned was absolutely amazing. I wanted to remind you guys that we I wanted to thank you guys again, but also remind you guys that tomorrow we also have a full day starting at 12 p.m. Central Standard Time. We have a bunch of really amazing panels coming up, some brought to you by Sevilla, Citibank, Google. We, to mention, not including, but I'm sorry, not limited to, but those that I've just mentioned. We also have Lacey Jordan coming as well. So for those who are here still watching us, there's a bunch to come that you guys should also tune into for tomorrow. If you guys got the email from me with your day two, make sure that you're using your day two link and not your day one. That will make it easier for you guys to jump on in. And if you guys have any questions, please email us at blackdesign@texasstate.edu. I'd like to thank you guys again for coming out and sharing your Friday evening with us. I'd like to thank you for the questions that you've asked for our panelists. I'd also like to shout out and thank Renee for being an amazing host and moderator today, as well as, you know, all of the other folks that participated in the panels. You guys did an amazing job, and I am so, so, so grateful to continue to work with you guys when we do this. So from the bottom of my heart to you guys, I just want to say thank you guys so much. I appreciate you guys for being here today and look forward to seeing you guys tomorrow. You guys have a good day and enjoy the music. Hey!